found in Ephesians 10 through 10:20. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand, therefore, and pass the belt of truth around your waist. Put on the breastplate of righteousness, and shoes for your feet. Put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all these, take the shield of faith, and with which you will be able to quench all the flame and arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always preserve in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mysteries of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly as I must speak. Amen.
Amen.
May be seated. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, having done everything to stand. Just stand firm. Just stand firm.
Yes.
Today we look at these concluding words of Ephesians. And they speak to us because we are a people living in a difficult time in a difficult world. Paul writes this letter to the Ephesians while he's in a difficult situation. Paul's in a Roman prison. Paul writes this letter and makes me understand that Paul's not so concerned about the physical condition that he's in. He's concerned about how we deal with the situations of life that concern us. So he's writing a letter of encouragement to a church that he loves so wonderfully, the church in Ephesus. But those words that he wrote are applicable for the church today. So we're invited to hear the words written to a church centuries ago, and they still have meaning for the church today. Paul writes these words and he says to them, finally, after you've done all the things, all that you know, after you've been faced with all of these things, finally, I have some words for you. Paul says to them, be strong in the Lord and in strength of his power. I always like reading this because Paul says, finally, after you've done all the other things, one thing you've got to remember is be strong. And Paul's not talking about my strength or your strength or the strength, the physical strength that the Ephesians had. Oh yeah, he's talking about that, but he's saying, be strong in the Lord. Be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Anybody, you think of the strength of God's power. Not in my power, but in the strength of God's power. In that power that dwells deep down inside of us, that power that goes in and makes it feel like something like fire shut up inside of your bones. Not on Sunday morning when you're in church shouting, but in every aspect of your life. He said, be strong in the strength of his power. And I said, think, what is the strength of God's power? His power is so strong until God is able to take us through any and everything. Yes, there may be difficult situations of life in this earth. Satan may be doing all kinds of things, but nothing is as powerful as God. created something out of nothing.
Yes.
Because the creative force of God will deliver us from the hell that we find ourselves in. God is able. God is able to deliver you out of the fiery furnace. God is able to walk you through the Red Sea. God is able to do all kinds of marvelous things in the midst of our situations of life. Just go ask Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Won't he do it? Ask the children of Israel, can he walk you across the river Jordan? Can he walk you across the Red Sea and leave behind in the wake Pharaoh's army? And we look at it, all your troubles at some point in time, you have to look back and say they are floating on a sea of forgetfulness. They are floating on a page where they can no longer affect me because I have embraced the grace and the love of God. Then God goes and he says, I know, Paul goes and says, I know you're going to face some difficult situations of life, but here's one thing I want you to know. If you do this, you will be able to hang on. So Paul goes through and he outlines some things for us. He said, put on the whole armor of God. I can put on the whole armor of God. And I like when you put on the whole armor of God when we read the story about David, when David got ready to go out and fight Goliath, this behemoth, this massive enemy in the land. They gave David an armor to put on. An armor that wasn't made for David. Made for somebody else. They had tailor-made it for David. So David put it on, started to put it on, and he said, I'm uncomfortable in here. I have to come and tell you today, you got to put on the whole armor of God, not one someone else constructed for you, but one that's tailor-made for you. When God picks you up, God will fix it so it will fit the situation of your life. The whole armor of God. And you look at me saying, what does it look like? I don't know, but I know when God looks at you, God knows what you need to get through the stuff that you are going through. If you're lonely, God got an armor for that. If you get hurt, God got an armor for that. God said, put on the whole armor of God. The whole armor of God is found in the word of God. First it says you ought to forgive those that do you in. And I think that's why Jesus came on the cross. And what he said while he was stretched out on the cross, he looked down at a mean world that was determined to kill him. And he looked up to heaven and he said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. He put the whole armor of God so you may be able to stand against the wild.
Yes.
He got some tricks up his sleeve. The wiles of the day would be the cunning, the scheming of the devil. So you'd be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. And we ought to sit down a while and think about what the wiles of the devil, what are they, and how they affect our lives. Paul gets here and he starts to talk about things here. In the next verse, he starts to talk about systemic devils and structural devils. And he talks about those. Sometimes we don't see them in that sense. We just see individual devils. But those we can deal with, we think we can deal with them, but we don't know how to deal with them. He says, so you'll be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Anything the devil throw at you. Anything the devil throw at you, you will be able to take care of. Can you think of some of the things the devil has thrown at you? Just coming to church on Sunday morning, the devil put some stuff in your way. Oh, we say it's the devil, but the devil put some stuff in your way. How many were tempted to turn around and go back home this morning? I was coming down and getting on the freeway and I'm riding along singing a song and something the devil said to me, you're going to be late when you get to church, but this is what I need you to know. I need you to know you left your sermon at home on your iPad. So I turn around and go back home and call up my wife to tell her that I missed something. And my wife came outside and she had one electronic device in her hand and she said, I don't see it. I'm like, where is it? So the devil looked and said to me, you lost it. You don't know where it is. So then I remember last night I was reading it and it was in a place and I went and got it and I came in the car and just all the way down the freeway it said, that guy cut you off. Why would he cut you off on Sunday morning if you're going to church? They would say, you ought to say something interesting about him. I said, Lord, bless him. Riding on down the street, coming on down the street, you get there, pull up, somewhere ran a red light. There was a I look at it and go like, our struggle is not against
flesh and blood.
Although people in flesh and blood can do some evil, despicable things. They can do something, they can become instruments of Satan. We think we see Satan masquerading as a human being, and maybe we do it sometimes, but we have to move our thoughts up higher about what those enemies are, those enemies that can take us out, those enemies that can destroy us, and they come down to a place and there is some systemic evil in our midst. It becomes a system of how we operate on a daily basis. Anybody ever thought about why you look at someone and you don't feel good about them? There's a system in control that teaches us how to do and how to act toward each other from when we're little babies all the way up. Don't believe it, just examine your life. I read in the book at home and it says, how are we taught to hate each other? How are we taught to do that? And I start to think about it, that's more than an individual thing, that's a collective thing. So when we start to talk about what we have to do, it says our struggle is not about, is not only against someone that stepped on your foot, our struggle is against that which causes us to act that way.
Yes.
Let me see. Our struggle is against that what causes us to look at someone and declare that they are less than we are because of the color of their skin.
Yes.
Causes us to look at someone because they speak a certain language and think they're less than they are. There's this systemic thing that's in place that teaches us daily. And then if it lasts long enough, it gets in the very fabric of society. And what happens when it gets in the fabric of society is because you are one thing, you are one way, people can treat you another way, can put you over here and leave you there. We can say that, and I know why Paul, and as I read this letter from Paul, I wonder what did Paul know about all of that. I said, Paul, remember that there was one time, although I loved the Lord, and I was a Pharisee, and I had sat at the feet of Gamaliel, and I had done some strong teaching, and I was one of the men, I was the man, but I realized that which I knew was not in alliance with what God knew about, what God knew and what God had in store for everybody. So God had to fix me one day. God had to transform me one day. And because God transformed me, Ephesians, I can sit in a jail cell in Ephesus. I can sit in a jail cell in Rome and write a letter to Ephesus and say, here's what you need to do. When you realize the goodness of God, when you realize what Jesus has brought you from, when you realize that God's mind, his thoughts, and his ways are higher than your ways, then you can write a letter and say to somebody, you need to put on the whole armor of God. And that whole armor of God will wrap you up and strengthen you up. It'll make you evaluate yourself. It'll make you evaluate your actions toward others. It'll make you get on your knees and ask God, how in the world have I become a greater person? Transform me by the power of God. And say, is there a way that we can stop this mean, vicious cycle of young people going to prison for little or nothing? Young people end up in prison for a long time for a minor offense, get more time than they can get for killing someone just because. But how do we do that? No, I won't let you off the hook. We have to start building communities. We have to start building communities that's inclusive of folk. We have to start telling folk that the house I live in, the car I drive, the clothes I wear, it's only a gift from God. And if I have a car, and you gave me a car, I ought to be able to let a lot of folk ride in it. That car ought not to become a status symbol for me. I shouldn't be concerned if someone get in my car, they're going to mess up the seat. They're going to mess up the carpet. They're going to do something else to it. Because let me tell you, a car will not describe who you are before God. Have wonderful seats in the sanctuary and be concerned about who's sitting on them. Because they may mess them up. I better leave there. Paul says, for our struggles are not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against authorities, against cosmic powers of the present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day. Maybe that day's here. you may be able to stand on that evil day. On that day when all things are going contrary. On that day when people are going purposely against God, against what God desires for our lives. It's not too complicated when human lives are measured in cents and dollars. It's not too complicated. It's when people look and we place more and more emphasis is placed on money than on human life. It's not too interesting to see when a corporation can come forth and have the same opportunity and say have the same privilege as a human being, but you can't suffer you can't suffer for doing wrong like a human being. In an evil day, when you look at things and right become politically expedient, when right's no longer politically expedient, is what will raise you in the polls. It's an evil day when people look and say that because health care to get you well, it costs this amount of dollars, but you are not worth these amount of dollars. It's an evil day. I was laughing, my wife asked me the other day, it was an evil day when we look and we see and we think that companies that make pills and the companies that dispense pills and the people that buy pills. And we were trying to determine in our neighborhood what's going on. There's a drugstore here, there's a drugstore here, there's a drugstore there, there's a drugstore everywhere. We were wondering what in the world is going on. So she started talking. We were talking, and I have a friend that's an undertaker. He said, whoa, here's something with this thing. So you take them and you take them and you take them, and finally you become dependent, you become upon me. So we were talking the other day, and I had a pain. You know my first thought was, what can I take? And you know what's wrong with me? I had overextended myself. But I was about to take a pain for the pill that I was feeling. I mean, they take a pill for the pain I was feeling. And if I take that pill, the pain will go away, but I need another one pretty soon. Because I said to myself, pain, where'd you come from? Pain, why are you hurting, Jimmy? What can I do to alleviate it? All I needed to do was cut back on what I was doing and realize what I was doing. And I'm feeling good this morning.
Martin King writing his little letter in prison. I was sitting there looking at it. It's uncomfortable in prison, but there's some things happening out here. And God, you want me to send a message from where I am to out there. How many of you know that sometimes your difficult place gives validity to what you're about to say? Let me see, that letter would have never been entitled A Letter from Martin King if he hadn't been sitting in a Birmingham jail when he wrote it. They would not have any names in it. You say, you can do infinitely more. Anybody ever wrote you a letter from where they were and say you can do infinitely more than you are doing? I believe that there's a letter somewhere to do outside. From the neighborhood we're in to all the churches, from the neighborhood that we're in, the people that are around, there's a letter somewhere saying to you, your job is this. In the face of all of these things, in the face of systemic racism, in the face of structural disenfranchisement, in the face of all these things, you can do infinitely more than you are doing. So we need to tie the gospel to our lives every day. And we need to tie the gospel to our lives. It's a radical declaration of what we ought to be doing. Paul said, put on and make a proclamation of the gospel of peace. When you put on the gospel, when you put on your shoes, start to walk there. I got shoes, you got shoes. Yeah. All of God's children got shoes to wear. Put on a shoe, and when you put your shoes on, they just let you walk through everything, through the thorny places of this earth you can walk through. That's not the kind of style you got on, but that God has showered you with the preparation of peace, that you can go walk in and say, with all these things, take on the shield, take the shield of faith. Shield of faith. Shield of faith. With which you will be able
destruction and set it on fire. Anybody ever felt like the arrows from the evil one, and when Satan said it, he just set your whole being on fire? It's from everywhere. And he said, take the shield of faith. Faith is believing that God can do anything.
Yes.
I don't understand it, but he can do it.
Yes.
I can't explain it, but he can do it.
Yes.
Faith is the substance of things hoped for.
Yes.
Evidence of things. I don't know how you're going to do what you're going to do, God, but you said you were going to do it.
Yes.
Here I am. Whatever happens, I'm just here.
Yes.
So he said, take on the shield of faith. Faith can shield you from anything.
Amen.
Means that faith can shield you, and whatever is coming up against you won't have the ability to destroy you, because you believe that God will take care of you. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God.
Amen.
Study the Word of God. In God's Word, you will find directions to help you go along your way. But make certain you make application to your life. Don't take the Word of God and use it to look at other people and judge who they are. My wife was at home yesterday, and on my Facebook, someone sent me a really interesting little thing. It said, before you judge anybody, make sure you know what you're about to do. And it had several scenarios on there. And the last one got me, the guy was walking his dog in the park, walking along, and he had a brown in his hand. And some other people were looking, and something happened, and dropped his brown on the ground. So he was right behind the little dog. Picked his brown yogurt, started to eat it, and there were some other people watching it. You know what they thought. I said, oh my, thought that he was doing that, which is so out of my mind. But no one has seen the whole story. No one, they didn't see what had happened. They didn't see all the things that had taken place before them. They just looked and said, this is what I saw. And this, sometimes when we look at people and we see their lives, we don't know what happened to them. We start to see the moment here, but we don't know how they got to where they are. We don't know why sometimes people are walking around and like I do sometimes, my head is twitching because I can't. Trying to keep the cobwebs out of it. Trying to get God. We don't know sometimes why people are walking backwards. We don't know why they're saying the things we need to say. We need to get the whole story and say, and I'm going to be in there with you. I will talk with you. I will realize who you are, and I will try and form a relationship with you so that we can come together and that we can be in a relationship, and God will help you through me, and God will help me through you. And said the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, because in this word it says we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And when it said all of us, that means me too. So I have to be, there goes me except for the grace of God. There goes me except for God's love and God's grace. There goes me except for people that are around me that are helping me up. It says pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Spirit. Pray at all times. I like this. It says pray in the Spirit. And to that end, keep alert and always preserve in supplication for all the saints. Pray in the Spirit and stay alert. When we pray, do you realize what God does when you pray? Anybody have a little talk with Jesus this morning? Call him all about their trouble. He'll hear my prayer. He'll answer by and by. So when we talk, when I talk to the Lord, it's a two-way conversation. I start to tell the Lord what's going on with me, and the Lord will touch me on the soul sometimes and say, Jimmy, it's more important that you know what's going on with me, because you have a minute picture of what's going on. The little minutia that you are concerned about means nothing. Why don't you look and see the large picture? Why don't you see what's going on? See what I'm doing in the world. So here we come. If we pray all the time, God will help us see the principalities in this world. God will help us see the evil situations of this world. You ever sit down to watch the news, and that you were watching the news, start to pray? Someone told me yesterday, they're shooting folks everywhere. I said, yeah. He said, they're robbing folks everywhere. I said, yeah. See, every week something wrong happens. Something difficult happens. In our neighborhood, never give us answers to what's going on with us. Somebody looked this morning and said, why did you let the little kids come to sing after one was so anxious to sing that she fell down the stairs? I think she's okay. But if we don't cultivate in them the anxiety about expressing what's inside of them, we don't cultivate in them that I am so important. I'm just as important as anybody else, and I know I'm going to grow up and I'm going to be a powerful woman. Just wait till I get old enough. I may even be president of the United States. I could even be Michelle Obama. Just wait till I grow up. Just wait, because nobody has told me I can't do anything. Everybody told me you can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthened me. I got on the whole armor of God. When folks look at me and say, you can't do this, I said, that's just fine. That's what you think, but what God thinks about me is different than what you think. What God has described me to do is different than what you described. I'm going to go on anyway. I'm going all the way anyway. Going as far as I can go and as far as God wants me to go. And I will not be limited by what you have to say. You can put me in prison. I'll write letters about my experience. You can do anything you want to me. I will keep on shouting out that God has been good. You need to look around, and when you're in a situation, you need to count some blessings instead of counting the restrictions. You need to count your blessings so you can do something about the restrictions. Because if you count your blessings, then God will give you some strength to do something about the restrictions. And some of those restrictions, you can move. So here he comes. He said, pray for me. He said, always keep alert. Wake up. I think it's a popular saying. It says, wake up, everybody. No more sleeping in bed. Wake up. Talk about what's happening. Have a conversation about the school system. Have a conversation about the justice department. Have a conversation about everything that affects our lives. Have a conversation for God's sake about the upcoming and the pending presidential election that's coming up. Have a conversation. Even if you don't know it, you just start talking about it. And then go find out about it and tell someone something else about it. Know about all the candidates. Know about Bernie. Know about Hillary. Know about Donald. Know about all the other folks. Know about them and talk about them. Someone told me the other day, and just because someone is a Democrat, just because someone is a Republican, you need to come together and talk about it, because guess what? If you don't talk about it, it doesn't matter who ends up in there. When Satan's doing stuff in your life, tell God about it. Amen. When you tell God about it, when God delivers you, tell everybody about it. Yeah. Yeah. He thought he had it. Let's see.